Mention piece number one, beer is a generic name. When you speak of ale or lager, you're speaking of particular kinds of beer. Beer really is a very general name. It's not even necessarily the name of a malt liquor. In the
highly recognized, and indoleacetic acid is produced from tryptophan, and of course tryptophan is a succinic acid pathway product, so that gives us a relationship in that sense. And indoleacetic acid, when present in high amounts, will stimulate extensibility of cells, plant cells, and cause increased growth. In fact, the specific effect of indoleacetic acid is not really understood, but they think that, at least present thinking, according to a review by Ray in Volume 7, Recent Advances in Phytochemistry, which is published just recently, 1974, summarizes the information on how auxin or indoleacetic acid acts. And for a long time, it was thought that it was acting by stimulation of RNA and through RNA protein synthesis. But now they're pretty well convinced that the effect is too rapid for that. The protein synthesis can't be stimulated as rapidly as the effects of auxin are. Therefore, they're looking for other effects. And at the moment, they think that it has something to do with the specific lowering of pH at a membrane site, and there is evidence for specific binding on some unidentified cellular membrane that occurs with IAA. In other words, they don't really know, but it does seem to be involved in a specific excretion of acid and changing the pH at a very localized membrane site, which then leads to other effects. Now, there are a number of there's a great mass of information as to what happens to plants on application of exogenous indoleacetic acid and similar compounds, and something about endogenous levels and how they change. Just to give you some example of how complicated it can get, the effect of ethylene can also be to govern or influence how rapidly plant cells grow, and it seems that the two tend to counteract each other. So in other words, ethylene has one mechanism of control and indoleacetic acid another, but they both appear to affect the hydroxyproline type proteins in the cell walls. Now this is quite interesting because they've only recently been studying hydroxyproline in plants, because when I was in school, I did get my PhD as a protein chemist, and at that time it was essentially understood that hydroxyproline was a major constituent of collagen of animals, and that was about the only place it was found in nature. Well, in terms of high concentrations, that's still true, but apparently these very specific but difficult to isolate proteins of the plant cell wall also have a high hydroxyproline content. And ethylene seems to act by stimulating the production of this hydroxyproline type small polypeptides, which diffuse from the cell into the cell wall and bind to make proteins of animals, collagen, and the structural cell wall proteins of plants are now looking more and more similar. In any case, in that regard, the indoleacetic acid inhibits the production of this hydroxyproline, or at least transfer of the peptides through the cell wall, and so the two, ethylene and indoleacetic acid, have rather opposite effects, at least in that regard. You can show that if you have a higher indoleacetic acid content, at least, the cell walls are more extensible, less rigid, and without going any further into it, this correlates with the tendency to grow. So that if you have high indoleacetic acid content, the plant is rapidly growing in the vegetative condition. If you inhibit or diminish the content of indoleacetic acid, you'll throw it into maturation with seed production and so forth. And such things are very important from an agricultural viewpoint, and therefore have been studied a lot. Well, the Indole-acetic acid is produced essentially all the time in the plant, apparently, although subject to some controls. And what really controls the level present is its rate of destruction. And the rate of destruction is, or the mechanism of destruction, by oxidation through indole-acetic acid oxidase, which produces this inactive derivative. And it's then further metabolized and lost. So in terms of controlling effective rate, it would be the indole-acetic acid oxidase enzyme that would do the job. Now, the way the phenols come into the story, besides being involved in the tryptophan synthesis story, indirectly at least, would be that it was originally shown by Gartner and Kent, again, good pineapple friends of mine, who showed that with indole-acetic acid oxidase, not only from pineapple, but from a few other plants, the presence of paracumaric acid stimulated the indole-acetic acid oxidase, which in turn would mean then lowering the indole-acetic acid level and throwing the plant into the mature type stage and decreased growth rate. Whereas on the other hand, the dihydroxy derivatives like caffeic acid inhibited the indole-acetic oxidase and would encourage the retention of indole-acetic acid and more rapid growth. Now this turns out to have been studied, considering its apparent importance, I think it's been studied relatively little. However, there is continued study along this line, and the picture has turned out to be perhaps a little more complicated because, and therefore a little less certain, that this is the primary control method. And I will have to admit that although I personally believe, and there are others that are publishing that believe, this is a, if not the, primary control method of regulating relative effective levels of indole-acetic acid oxidase, others don't agree. And one reason they don't agree is that the whole system is not quite as clear-cut as we're implying. In general, it's so that the monohydroxy-type derivatives do stimulate the indole-acetic acid oxidase, and the dihydroxy, bisphenol dihydroxy type of compounds do inhibit. And this is often true for simple compounds, like I don't think phenol has been tried, but certainly catechol is effective in the case of the inhibition effect. If phenol has been tried, I'm not sure, but it is poisonous for other reasons, so that it hasn't been so regularly used. But even flavonoids, so camphorol would behave as a stimulant, and quercetin, for instance, would behave as an inhibitor of IA oxidase. But the reason it gets complicated is that you get into problems like ferulic acid, which would have the dihydroxy structure, but would be methylated. And it turns out that in most plants that it's been studied, it depends on what else is there. For instance, Gartner and Kent showed that if you had no, in an in vitro test, no paracumaric acid present, then ferulic acid was a weak stimulator. And that might make sense because it is a monohydroxy compound. But if paracumaric acid was present, then it became a potent inhibitor. And the inference was then that in the presence of paracumaric acid, there was a mechanism to remove the methyl group, and it would then behave as the caffeic derivative. But again, you see, it becomes complicated because it depends on what else is there. Now, that's not so unreasonable, of course, because that there's going to be a confusion factor, because in an intact plant system, paracumaric acid, of course, can be converted to caffeic by phenyloxidase. So polyphenyloxidase can hydroxylate this compound to produce this compound. And again, then, while that does complicate the interpretation of the thing, it suggests a real functional role for polyphenyloxidase, which up till now has not been very clear-cut. Polyphenyloxidase is present in nearly all plant tissues at some level, and in some plant tissues at very high levels, and it seems that it must have a role, or it wouldn't be there. Now, it does have a role in response to injury, but it would appear that it would need to have some effective roles in more normal metabolism, and this may well be where it does have such a role. In any case, this is an example of the complications, and another example of the complications is that pH can affect the whole system. Apparently, these inhibitors are acting as electron acceptor type reactants. So the behavior of the monophenol particularly is as electron acceptor. Well, as, if it's going to be an electron acceptor, then this is going to be affected by pH. And that seems to be true even in these compounds because quercetin, for example, can be shown, depending on the pH of the medium, to act as both an inhibitor and a stimulator, depending on pH. So that you change the medium, you change its ability to accept or give up electrons, and then you'll change how it affects the oxidase system. Again, that's reasonable because the indole-acetic acid oxidase is a peroxidase, an iron-containing heme-type enzyme, and so it would be reasonable that redox poising and the pH effects related to it would affect the activity. So I guess the best summary we can make at the present time is that it does appear that the phenols do have a regulatory role in controlling indole-acetic acid oxidase. It's not generally agreed as to how critical this is as the only or the primary mechanism of this control. But there's not any better evidence on any other system, and it appears to me that with better understanding that it is going to become more and more recognized as the important factor. This has some relationships that we've hinted at as we went along that I think are quite important. For instance, we mentioned in the boron toxicity, boron deficiency situation with grapes that the symptoms look as if you're producing IAA or 2,4-D type damage in the plant, so that it suggests an IAA relationship to the accumulation of high levels of phenols. In the twining, it's suggested that because it's light related, and certainly as it twines, the outer side of the tendril is growing more rapidly than the inner side. So there's a differential growth rate, which would imply an auxin interaction. And the camphorol quercetin ratio would appear to fit well in this regard. And one that we haven't mentioned is in the connection with galls. There's a great relationship between tannin, gallic acid. Gibberellin, you may know, also relates to extensibility. Gibberellin was discovered in Japan when they were studying what they called the foolish shoot or foolish stunt. I've forgotten. Anyway, the Japanese name for a condition in the rice paddy where certain plants of rice grew twice as tall as anything else. And they couldn't quite figure out why. And then they found it was because those rice plants were infected by Gibberella fukuori, I believe was the name of the organism, a mold. And then when they isolated the mold and grew it in vitro, it found it produced this hormonal-like material we know as gibberellin, or the group of compounds of gibberellins. Well, the gibberellins then cause extension of the rice plant in that condition, and there are certain types of dwarf plants that are apparently naturally deficient in the normal hormonal level of gibberellic active compounds, and they can be converted from dwarf corn, say, to normal-sized corn by the exogenous application of gibberellin. Of course, we know of gibberellin in the grape business for other reasons, such as loosening up clusters and that sort of thing. But again, it acts mainly by extending cell walls and increasing growth, particularly in the linear sense, of the more vascular type tissues. Well, this seems to have an interrelation with phenols, and possibly through double interaction through indole-acetic acid, but we're not sure of that. But for instance, a number of studies have shown that gibberellin treatment is related to phenol content. For instance, low levels, physiological levels of gibberellin added I've forgotten what plant this was, inhibited, added to a plant anyway, inhibited anthocyanin and other flavonoid synthesis. And this was more effective the lower the light intensity. In other words, there seemed to be a phytochrome interreaction or possibly a high energy reaction with light. Gibberellin's known to break the dormancy of certain seeds which are held in dormancy apparently by phenols, or at least addition of coumarin or naringenin would antagonize the effect of gibberellin in breaking the dormancy of certain seeds. And you can find many more examples. One of the more striking ones is that if you apply gibberellin to the leaves of a persimmon tree 3 days before you harvest the persimmons, the storage life, which mainly means tannin conversion from soluble to insoluble form, because the ripe persimmon to be edible, the tannin has to be converted to insoluble form, you'll prolong or double the time it takes for the persimmon to soften and ripen. I don't think it, in that study at least, it wasn't shown that the tannin level was increased. I suspect it was. But in any case, it certainly was affected, and its further metabolism was affected. And lignification is affected. Of course, that's why the extension of the one reason the Japanese were interested in studying this foolish shoot disease was that the rice grew too tall and then fell over, so that, of course, it wasn't harvestable and so on. So that lignification, or at least strength, was minimized by the addition of the gibberellin. And often that is true, although, as you notice in your notes, at least some instances you can promote lignification and PAL formation, particularly in dwarf pea, for example. In the case of the dwarf pea, it appears that one reason it's a dwarf is that it is responding to the fact that it doesn't lignify well by staying small, you see. If it could lignify, it would grow larger, apparently. And as far as we can get down to cases, it appears that gibberellin acts by blocking an early reaction, which is phytochrome mediated. And phytochrome controls growth by regulating phenol synthesis, which in turn regulates IAA level. At least that's the way it appears to hang together the best, so that gibberellin has more indirect effect on the phenols, but they do interact because gibberellin affects the phytochrome, which we said also affects phenol synthesis. Now, we mentioned ethylene earlier. Ethylene is only now becoming clear as to its production in plants, biosynthesis, and it appears that ethylene is produced from methionol. It's interesting that these things are tied into the amino acid metabolism, but if we have methionine So methionine is converted apparently to methionol, which would be the fusel oil type compound again, the first time that fusel oil becomes important in metabolism, to my knowledge. And where the extra carbon goes, I don't know. But anyway, the best evidence at the moment, or last I knew, was that methionol, which would be this compound, is the carbon source of the ethylene. I'm not quite sure, but I suppose it's these two carbons then that become the ethylene. In any case, the best evidence that I'm aware of is that methionine gives methionol, and that gives the carbons that lead to ethylene production. So that the amino acids are tied into the picture at least. And the one of the effects of ethylene is to stimulate PAL, phenylalanine ammonulase production, and also cinnamic acid 4-hydroxylase, so that the production of phenols would be stimulated by ethylene, and again, an interaction is apparent. Not only that, but there is some evidence that paracoumaric acid is a required cofactor in the conversion of methionol to ethylene. And for instance, Mayer, Harrell, and Shane, who've also worked, at least Mayer and Harrell, have worked on the polyphenol oxidase of grapes and have done the best work so far on the Browning enzyme of grapes, have shown that when you have a rather specific inhibitor of polyphenol oxidase, this can interact so that catechol no longer would inhibit the production of ethylene. So in other words, inhibiting, even though the Browning enzyme would act on catechol presumably by converting it only to a quinone, so it might be a non-specific type effect, nevertheless, if you inhibit this enzyme, you do inhibit the effect of catechol on ethylene production. So again, a phenolase regulatory or control mechanism is suggested. Now, these ideas are pulling a lot of things out of left field together, and I don't want you to go away with the idea that these are proven by any means. There are people where sugar level and a few other things are interacting in important ways. Nevertheless, it seems to me that if phenols are going to be the most important and widespread secondary plant products, and I wouldn't have said that myself, but I'm quoting from a article I read very recently, and since he said it, and I believe he's right, I'm willing to quote him. These compounds are present very widely, almost universally, and these suggestions of important relationships have not been refuted, and they're becoming more and more convincing, it seems to me, as we get more specific information. And this brings us finally then to some of the enzyme turnover relationships, which are very new. At least the references I have here were all in the past year, well, all but one, and add extra information. For instance, we said earlier that not very much is known about the degradation of phenols in plants. There's a good deal known about the biosynthesis, but not much on the conversion back into carbon substances other than phenols. Well, that's not as true anymore. More work is being done on turnover numbers, and such numbers as given in your notes, from 1 to 100 nanomoles per gram per hour. Now let's take just a quick look at that. 100 nanomoles per hour is the same as 100 millimoles, and I can think easier in millimoles for some reason or other, per kilogram instead of per gram. And that would be per hour. Now, if we're talking about, say, catechin, for example, the molecular weight is 290. So 100 millimoles would be 100 times the millimolecular weight, so 290 milligrams times 100. Well, that would be a turnover rate of 29 grams per kilogram of grapes, say, per hour. And I don't think I have to argue with you and say that's one whale of a metabolic activity. And in tissues that are metabolizing at this rate, practically all of the carbon that's being metabolized is going to phenols. In other words, the phenol production is the primary, almost exclusive place that the carbon is being put at that time. We can find, and this is in fact a turnover rate. In some other cases, they're talking about an accumulation rate, so that the rate of accumulation is over, and if you're going to accumulate something, but you're also degrading it, then the accumulation would be certainly slower or smaller than the actual production rate. So that if you study turnover rate, you get one figure, you get a much lower one with accumulation, and even then, the accumulation of phenol is very, very large in many cases. Now, the enzymes that are associated with these syntheses have been studied, and Griesbach and Halbrook have been the leaders in this kind of work. And for instance, they've been studying in parsley tissue cultures a family of 13 enzymes that are involved in phenolic conversions. And they find a very interesting thing that in these tissue cultures and in certain types of seedling sprouting and so forth, that they get very rapid production of these enzymes from a low or non-measurable level to a very high level, and they get such graphs as this and this, where one group of enzymes has a maximum at about 15 hours, and there is, I shouldn't start it at zero, there is a lag period of a few minutes to a few hours, a lag period of the order of an hour and a half or 2 hours. In the case, one case given here is 2.5 hours. Then you start illumination, you begin to form these enzymes in the tissue culture, and the peak here is at about 15 hours for the enzymes as a group that are concerned with the phenylpropanoid type compounds like caffeic acid and any C6C3 type compound. So that phenylalanine ammonia lyase, cinnamic acid 4-hydroxylase, and so on, converted to some relative units. So say on a percentage, the curves tend to fall right on top of each other. So as a group, something like five or more enzymes that are concerned with phenylpropanoid synthesis follow this curve. And then the rest of the enzymes that are concerned with flavonoid production tend to have a similar lag and tend to rise similarly, but more slowly, and at least in the up to 25 hours, where mostly they have had to stop the experiment for other reasons, have not yet peaked. If you do follow them in an intact plant instead of in the tissue culture, they do level off, and as the plant gets more mature, they will drop as well. So that the typical situation is that you start producing the enzymes that make the phenols very early in what might be considered the normal growth. The illuminated tissue culture would start producing the phenol-producing enzymes very soon. In the case of the cinnamic derivatives, would reach a maximum of enzyme quite early, 15 hours, and then they would fall off considerably. And as the tissue gets old, the same would be true with a later and wider peak on the flavonoid-producing enzymes that convert these compounds into the flavonoids. In the very old or post-mature type tissues, the levels are still present, but quite a bit lower, approaching zero again. Well, this certainly indicates the fact that they're produced so early, and this is true in plants not only in tissue culture, but shoots and rapidly growing plant parts. They're produced so early and then diminish as the plant gets mature, indicates again an important role in metabolism. Otherwise, why produce them at a time when the energies of the plant are going into growth and so forth? Light response, of course, is related to PAL synthesis, and these data here would indicate it, but it's been mentioned several times. And an interesting example is in the fungus Sporobolomyces roseus, which is mentioned in your notes. And that's interesting. If we had time, I don't know a lot about it, but I'd like to tell you more about these fungi. But this is an interesting one, and it has a fruiting head, that the when the fungus mold begins to produce the fruiting head, it has a spore at the top, a single spore in the fruiting head that's under some kind of pressure. And when it grows in the dark, this spore is held tightly. But if it sees, if you want to put it that way, light, it'll fire that spore right at the light. And for instance, if you grow this mold in a box with a pinhole, and these spores are sticky, they're black, so that you can grow it in the box and take the lid off of the pinhole in it, and you'll see all the spores that didn't go through the hole within about a 2-inch circle around there. In other words, they're pretty accurate at firing the spore at light, you see. Well, that shows they've got a very good response to light, is the point I want to make. So that's why the use of sporobolomyces is very sensible. And in that case, it's shown that the presence of light produces a much higher phenol synthesis, and evidently because of the phenylalanine ammonialase effect. And also, then the phenol content is much higher in the presence of light. And this, in turn, again, seems to be a protective mechanism, so that the possible damaging effect of very high light is responded to by synthesizing a lot of phenol, which protects the fungus against the possibly damaging effect of the light. And this, of course, in a plant that has no chlorophyll and doesn't photosynthesize and so on. So it is a rather obscure but a very intriguing example, I think, of the interrelationship of phenols and light in the high level as a protective agent. And this cold response story has always been a real bothersome thing. We know it, we teach it, but we don't know why. It seems very strange, or how even. Very strange that the plant is able to produce more phenols when it's cooler than when it's warmer. Well, some fairly recent evidence, and if you look at the paper by Creasy and Zucker, and the other one mentioned by Smith in these two fairly recent books, you'll need to read both papers to begin to get a synthesis of the story. But the way I put it together from the two papers is that the evidence seems to be that phenylalanine level, phenylalanine ammonialase level, is very critical to this whole story. Not only, of course, from the phenol metabolism story, but from the phenylalanine tyrosine metabolism story. And Creasy and Zucker have made a very clear exposition of the fact that the regulation of phenylalanine and tyrosine is quite rigidly controlled and separate from the phenol control. So that the phenol production is compartmentalized in some fashion away from the phenylalanine ammonialase participation, phenylalanine is not controlled by the PAL level, because the PAL level can go up and down tremendously, and the substrate, the phenylalanine, stays nearly constant. So there are other mechanisms to control the phenylalanine level within rigid limits. And so the high production of phenols can't be due to the excess production of phenylalanine or anything of this sort. And there is a sharp differentiation then between the primary substance control and the secondary substance control, which is rather important. And then PAL level is apparently being, the phenylalanine ammonialase is apparently being made all the time, even in the dark. And its level, somewhat like the indole-acetic acid level then, is controlled by its destruction. And it apparently is destroyed in two ways. One by as yet unknown destructive mechanism, and an inhibitor system that prevents its activity. Well, it appears that at least one of these inhibitors is cold sensitive. And the phenylalanine ammonialase is being synthesized, albeit maybe at a slower level when the plant is cold, but the inhibitor is holding all that is made in the bound form. And then as soon as the temperature rises, this is released, and you have a big upshoot in phenylalanine ammonialase level, which follows then to produce a much higher level of phenol. So it would appear the crucial thing in the cold stimulation of phenol production is a fluctuation of temperature, and not just cold. And that jives with our knowledge, of course, of the field condition, but also suggests some good experiments that I hope in the next few years will really clarify this. But it does explain then that you would produce phenylalanine ammonialase, hold it by binding it with the inhibitor in the cold condition. As soon as it warms up, the inhibitor complex breaks down. You have a much higher than normal level of phenylalanine ammonialase, which leads then to production of more phenol. Does anyone want to raise questions or talk further about the plant physiological aspects then? Because the next thing I'd like to talk about is the plant pathological relations. The ether? No, it hasn't been really shown. All that's been studied is a series of compounds with this kind of structure. And it does appear, if you study, and it's mentioned in your notes, if you study the pitunidin-like compounds, for instance, this sort of structure also behaves as if it were a dihydroxy substance, which might be seem reasonable. But so do the ones that have the methyl groups like the ferulic, and it's true of a number. Even, I believe I'm right, even if the methyl group is in the abnormal position. So it would appear that there is a mechanism of removing the methyl group, and although that's an ether, it's apparently fairly easy to remove. I have some evidence from a chemical viewpoint that it tends to fall off pretty readily in relatively mild conditions in the analysis of phenols. So, no, I guess to answer correctly, most of what's known about it is by using model compounds of a definite type, and it's never been shown with radioactive methyl groups or whatever that, in fact, it does come off. But the inference is that it probably does. Any other? Okay, well, the plant pathological relationship of phenols can be quite important and is more generally agreed to than some of the things I've just been telling you, even though I don't think it's perhaps as important. I've given you several general references. I might add one more as a very recent, not so recently published, but recent came to my attention, a paper by Deverell. Deverell. And a symposium volume called Phytochemical Ecology, Phytochemical Ecology, which is one of the symposium series of the British Phytochemical Society, and it was published in 1972 by Academic Press. And this is chapter 13, pages 217 to 233. This is a rather good reference on phytoalexins, and we'll come to those just in a moment. Phenols are involved in several ways in the resistance of plants to pests and diseases, and a couple of introductory comments might be important to note. First of all, many potential plant pathogens are not pathogenic to a given plant, and apparently then this means that the plant is completely able to resist them. And so it's a rather rare thing, and oftentimes the combination of pests, say mold, Phytophthora infestans, or some such pathogenic, phytopathogenic mold, the interaction between certain strains, at least, of the mold or even that mold with certain plants is very specific. And I guess the point I want to make is that there are lots of microorganisms that are potential pathogens and successful pathogens on some plants that have no effect on others. So that the normal condition, actually, is the resistance. And perhaps we need to give more credit to the phenolic substances and maybe other mechanisms that make most plants resistant to most potential plant pathogens. On the other hand, the successful pathogen is one that overcomes whatever defense mechanisms there are and successfully invades the plant. And the usual case we're interested in is the resistant varieties or selections within an otherwise susceptible pathogen host complex. But again, it's important to remember that by and large, plants are not easily affected by these creatures and do have then good mechanisms to prevent them. Some of them may be very nonspecific, such as high lignification, thick cuticle, high oil content, and a number of such things. I was just reading, for example, that one reason that citrus fruits are not generally attacked on the surface of the fruit, at least, by many insects, and I hadn't thought about this before, but they say that the flavido, which you know is the yellow skin of an orange, say, has little oil droplets. You're well aware of this as you peel the fruit, or if you bend the skin, you can see it firing little streams of terpene-bearing oil. And it turns out that this is under pressure in the plant. And so if an insect tries to eat it, he gets showered in the face with a big blast of orange oil. Well, you can imagine, you've maybe gotten it in your eye, it burns a good deal. And I would think if you were down to the size of a bug, it might be a pretty good protective agent. So that this kind of thing is sometimes pretty important and maybe fairly nonspecific. Phenols, however, seem to be very specifically indicated in pathogen limitation or resistance. And it's interesting that if you take phenols of a synthetic sort or natural sort either for that matter, you'll find that they are generally inhibitory. In fact, in the case of bacteria, we use or did use, still sometimes use a thing called the phenol coefficient, where basically you're comparing a disinfectant with the effect of phenol itself as an effective inhibitor of the microorganism concerned. And this is generally so that phenols are broadly inhibitory, even to plant cells under some circumstances, and certainly to pathogens and insects and so on. We've usually focused on food plants, and it's quite true that food plants generally have been selected by either man or animals for a low phenol content because they are either not tasty or astringent or inhibitory in some way. The very high tannin, high phenol content plants are generally not chosen as food for humans or domestic animals. As a consequence, we've had a tendency to look at the plants that are fairly deficient in this regard when we've been talking about plant pathological studies. This then suggests that the normal phenols can be inhibitory at some level, particularly if localized in the epidermal tissue or the invasion sites of the organism. So it may be very significant that in many plants, as we've mentioned, the tannins and other phenols tend to be clustered around the vascular tissue, so that an invading organism coming through the vascular tissue, vascular tubes, would encounter high tannin levels as it tried to escape this fairly external vascular system, or at the epidermal surface, or very just below it, where again, invasion would have to encounter a high level of phenol first. So that the high level of phenols does often occur and is often compartmentalized so that it can be an important inhibitory mechanism. And we have a few examples. It also can be true in dead tissue. So bark, for example, is ordinarily very high in phenols and therefore particularly inhibitory. Heartwood is essentially dead, and it's interesting that the trees that will survive termites and being used as posts in the earth and so forth are generally ones with very high phenol content, and by the same token, they're the ones that you don't find in the forest as a hollow tree too often because the high tannin and other constituents tend to inhibit any creature that would want to eat the inside of the tree. So the giant redwoods have lived long and are great for wine tanks, partly then because of their high tannin content that keeps anything from growing on the surface of the wood or rotting the wood too easily. Some phenols are converted from less inhibitory to more inhibitory forms by enzymatic action during infection of one kind or another. So that, for instance, the glycosides are often hydrolyzed to the aglycones, and these are often more inhibitory than the glycoside, not only to the invader in some cases, but to the plant itself. There is a parasitically enhanced accumulation of phenols at the injury site. And so even the normal phenols may tend to collect by either translocation or local synthesis, probably the latter in most cases, in the immediate vicinity of a lesion. So if you take a cut potato, if you cut a potato, you'll find if you plot the phenol content that the first millimeter, giving it a time to respond to the cutting, a few hours later, the first millimeter has a much higher content of phenols than the second millimeter, and you get in about 4 or 5 millimeters and there's no difference. It's just like the uncut potato. So that there is a localized accumulation of phenols related to mechanical injury. Oftentimes this is also related to beginning of lignification and to heal the lesion, so that the response is something more than a response to the pathogen. It's also a response to the fact that if you're going to heal that surface, you want to form a bark or a suberized layer over the outside, and lignification will seal it off, and then you can set about repairing the damage inside, so that the protective mechanism isn't just to inhibit the invader. It'll do it if even if it's a mechanical injury, but it will also tend to wall off any feeding insect, feeding person for that matter, if it could move fast enough. This brings us to a group of compounds called the phytoalexins, and this is a word that means warding off. Phyto means plant, and the alexins literally mean plant warding off substances then, or plant warding off, and then the substances is implied. These are generally compounds that we now know to be present in the plant prior to infection or injury in tiny amounts. For a long time we said they weren't present before, but it does appear now that they are present, but in very small amount, so that it's a similar reaction to the accumulation of the normal phenols at the site of injury, except in these specially adapted cases, the substances are much more inhibitory, so they're almost like antibiotics, and they are specially inhibitory to usual pathogens and are produced for this purpose, apparently, because they're otherwise not present in a reasonable amount. I think I'll want to come back to some additions to your list, but in case I don't have the time, at least on page 3 of these notes, you have a list of several examples which are phenolic and the different plants in which they occur. Several are isoflavone-type compounds, and some are derived from more simple phenols. These compounds are apparently produced in response to injuries in pretty well-known examples in specific plants. And this brings me then, and I'll take the last minute and a half of the class, to say something about the hypersensitivity reaction, which is the important concept that I want to leave you with this morning. The hypersensitivity story indicates that this synthesis of phenols at the site of invasion is an extremely important mechanism because it tends to prevent most organisms from getting in, particularly the non-pathogens, the ones that turn out to be unsuccessful infective agents. And the hypersensitivity idea says this: if we have, say, a fruit or whatever, and an insect or a mold or something begins to invade, you're damaging the tissue. Now, particularly if this invader is an obligate parasite, in other words, it's got to live on the living tissue, one way you can head this off is for the plant to respond oversensitively, hypersensitively, and die ahead of the invasion. And if you can die fast enough and die ahead of the invading organism so that this tissue is dead, you get a high phenolic content, you begin to suberize and wall it off, the invader can't penetrate through the dead tissue because it can't live in dead tissue. It can only live in freshly killed or living tissue. So that the very fact that the response of the plant is to die ahead of the invader seems to be related to the excessive production of the phenol. So just as the high production of phenol in boron deficiency can kill the plant and produce necrotic spots, this seems to be a normal reaction, and you do have the dying of the plant tissue, which then on the face of it might seem to be risky, but in fact does prevent the further invasion of the invading organism. Okay, we will plan on the test.